Next up, we have Boris Prikhodskiy. Did I get it right?
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. On the first try.
Yeah, that's not easy.
And the clicker for you.
Somebody stole it.
Oh, yeah. Where
is the
have the
clicker?
We're looking for a clicker, anyone. Here it comes.
Okay. Okay, no problem.
No worries. This is a professional conference, let me remind you, everybody. but yes, Boris, take it away.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. My name is Boris Prikhodskiy, and I'm QA Infrastructure Team Lead in Unity Technologies. And today, I'm very excited to share the results of our work of the two of our teams, QA Infrastructure and QA Frameworks. So, how does it work? Yeah. And the topic of my talk today is smart test execution or using automated test statistics to optimize or predict the test execution. Their execution, yeah. It works, yeah, it works. So what is Unity? So how many of you have heard about Unity? Quite a few. And how many of you have ever created anything with Unity? Oh, that's not that many, but after this talk, I think everybody will use Unity. Yeah, let's see. So first of all, Unity is very popular and very easy to work with and very easy to start with the game engine. So basically, you can create 2D and 3D games and augmented reality and virtual reality applications with Unity. You can easily do that as, yeah, clicker works. Yeah. You can easily do that as we have an asset store which already created content, and this is a sample content, free content that you can use. It looks pretty amazing. And you can easily create a game, as we also have a lot of, services. Like Unity Ads, you can put an ad in your game and earn money. You can use Unity Analytics to like find some most difficult levels that users, gamers are not happy with. And you can analyze everything, and basically a lot of stuff. But mostly, biggest advantage is that you can easily create a game and run it on 25 plus platforms, basically. A bit of more numbers, if the clicker works. Okay, I need to push the button. So yeah, we have around 5 million registered game developers. We have around 200,000 unique games created with Unity. And 700 million people actually playing Unity-made games, and around 1,700,000,000 mobile devices running Unity-made games. Yeah, so this is what we are dealing with in Unity. And Unity itself is a pretty big piece of software. We have around 2 million lines of code, and which is evenly split between platforms, editor and runtime, three major components of Unity. And all of that success and all that numbers wouldn't have been possible without the Unity test automation, obviously. A bit more numbers. We have around 30,000 tests, 10,000 unit tests, around 5,000 integration tests, 3,000 runtime graphics tests, and so on. And about a bit more statistics about the test runs. So daily we have around 1.5 million test runs and 10 million test runs a week and 40 million a month, and during the last year we've having 300 million test runs. So it's pretty a lot. And all of those tests, they obviously run on a build farm. And our build farm doesn't look like this. It has 180 agents, and we just delivered another build farm, which is even more powerful, like 400 agents. But still, the user experience that it's pretty slow. So what's led us to become successful, basically, with all those numbers and users and games and all the stuff, has become a bottleneck, right? So, and why is that? Let's see. So in order to understand that, we need to dig a bit into how the development is done in Unity. And it's done in branches. So when a team needs to develop some functionality, they branch out the main branch called trunk and develop their stuff in there. And then they, when they have their changes, which is called pull request, we basically, I'm just thinking that it is pretty common for all of you. So you need to get into the mainline, and which is called trunk, right? So how do we do that? So in order to pull request to get into trunk, you need to go through a peer reviews. Then you need to have a green ABV. ABV is a build verification, and A is because it needs to be in the top of the list, basically. Yeah, and this is a statical subset of tests. And the key here, the key point, that it is static. So basically, we always run some static subset of tests. It's not 30,000 tests that we have, but some subset. And they need to be green. So, and that's not all. Once the ABV is green, we add a pull request to a queue. And we take some of these pull requests by batches. And we run all of the tests that we have, pretty much all tests, on that batches. And if it's green, then we go to trunk. If not, we start the bisection process and trying to find out which actually individual pull request broke the stuff, right? So what is the problem with this? The problem is that ABV is slow. It may take from 3 to 6 hours for an ABV to get into, so actually for ABV to pass, depending on the load on the build farm. And when it happens, you just sit and wait how the send actually goes down and basically pray that everything actually works well, that there are no flaky tests, nothing happened bad, and so on, yeah. So, and we ask a question ourselves if we can speed it up. Yeah, let's try. But before doing that, we had to fix a problem with the a ways how to run tests. We used to have a lot of different kind of scripts for runtime tests, for native tests. They all were different. So we created a tool called Unified Test Runner, which is unify, which actually let you run tests in unified way, either on your local machine or on a build farm. And as a last step of UTR, basically, it sends all of the data to a database we created, also called Hoarder, which actually has the statistics on all tests. So here on the screen, you can see basically the statistics. I'm not sure whether it's visible because of the font, but size. But basically, you can see the pass rate, the median time. And so we know everything about our tests right now, all the history. So once we had that data, we found out that we have evergreen tests. So if you look at that column, basically you see that we have 100% successful tests, even though they have thousands of executions. And we actually came up with a pretty simple idea. Simple, but yet powerful. Let's just not run tests. How dangerously it could sound, but yeah, this is the idea. Let's not run tests which are 100% successful during last month, and which have around 100, which have more, sorry, more than 100 test runs. And on all branches, except the branches which are involved into merging into the mainline trunk. And that's a key point, because we do not just get rid of all tests. We get rid of green tests, and once they fail, and if they fail during the merge process, we'll know and we'll get them back onto the probation, and basically we will run them for another month. This is our idea. So some results. So we started with an hour and 20 minutes and the 1700 tests, and basically we went down to 30 minutes and 160 tests. So this is our results. So this is the most results that we have, like we enable that for free test suits. And sorry, probably, no, that's okay. That's good, it didn't work. So we went down from an hour from 40 minutes to 38 minutes and saved 63 minutes. But the biggest, the best result is that with an hour and 7 minutes, we went down to 23 minutes for mock tests, and we saved 44 minutes and 66% basically were saved. I'm not sure whether I have time, but these are actually graphs. On the horizontal line, you have minimum pass rate, and on the vertical, we should have actually the number of. Actually, it's a right slide, the minutes. So this is like we started with 100% minimum pass rate. So if we start playing with the numbers and go down to 99.75, then we can save not 20 minutes but even 10 minutes. So there is still a place, a space for improvement, and yeah, we'll skip that. Don't have time. So the probably next steps are to automatically find which test we excluded, but then which were failed during the merge process into the trunk. Right now it's manual. Another thing is so-called Boris mode. Probably I became famous. My team called it after me because I'm a big supporter of it. It's like right now we are looking at the all branches, and for instance, two teams developing in two separate branches. And if one team breaks tests, then it affects the other team. So basically, they're gonna run the same tests again and again. So my idea is just to look at the one branch and basically focus on that. But the most promising part, most promising next step is actually to use coverage to build a database, for instance, use an instrumented build, and run individual tests one by one and see which files were actually, which code from which files executed when that test is run, and build a database. So one, and then reverse it. When we have a commit, we have files, we change it. We look at the database and actually run only those tests that we actually were there. So this is the next steps. Results. Results are, we hope like the results are like this. Developers are gonna be happy because they spend less time. Users are gonna be happy because we develop new functionality faster, fix bugs faster. Yeah, this is where we are reaching. And those were just the first steps. First approach, we've been doing this for just a couple of months, and obviously there is a space for improvement. And I don't know if we have time for questions and ideas, comments. I would really appreciate that. Thank you.
Very good. Thanks, Boris. This was a lightning talk, so no time for jokes between. So going to the straight stuff.
Okay.
It's hard navigating this.
I think you need to go down and pick up the next question. Yeah, over here.
Oh, so there. All right, got it.
We'll exclude that time from my time.
All right, so what is a good balance between excluding tests and risk of breakages?
Yeah, this is an interesting question, and I think this is a key approach here. So we spend so much time waiting on the results of a test. So basically that time is not productive, right? A developer needs to, you know, switch to some other task, and we know that context switching is very costly operation, very expensive operation, whether it's a machines, computers, or humans. When we switch to between tasks, it's pretty expensive, right? So we thinking right now that we will take that risk.
If anyone has a question in the room, I'll ask the. Okay. Oh, I see you. I'll ask this question while I'm taking the mic over to you to save time. But great concept. Do you do periodic runs of evergreen tests, or are they ever dead?
No, this is the key point. We do not exclude them at all because we run all of them on trunk merge queue. So basically, every time the whole bunch of PRs are run, all tests are run for them. So basically, they keep being executed. So we do not get rid of anything. So we can kind of do periodical, but we do not need it as long as all the time there is a constant process of merging into the mainline trunk.
Hi, I'm Dasin from MathWorks. We actually have what we call test selectors kind of goes exactly what you're using. We have had like good experiences somewhat, but we have had usually a pretty bad experience with the fact that they put so much value on code coverage with new features coming in and things like that. It's kind of a dangerous ground if the code base has changed quite a bit, and then you're using that code coverage to choose the tests. And like, I was wondering what's your experience in that area.
It's very good that you asked that question and you shared your experience, because we haven't started doing the code coverage thing. We are just considering this as an addition to this process. So basically, we are switching from static execution of tests to dynamic execution of tests, and this is just the first step of it. So basically, we will try using the code coverage and see how it goes. But it's thank you for sharing your experience with us. We haven't started yet, so. You don't know.
All right, very good. Another hand for Boris.